Hi, my name is Jose Miguel Parrella, and I'm an open source specialist with Microsoft in Redmond, Washington. Today we're going to talk about how we can use Azure Virtual Machines for Ruby-based applications on top of our infrastructure as a service solution for the cloud. So the first thing that we're going to do is to go to Virtual Machines in my Windows Azure Management Portal and click on Images. So I have several images here. If I'm already using a hypervisor, say Hyper-V or VMware or KVM or any others, I can export the disk and I can upload it to Azure, where I can run Windows, Linux, virtual machines, and I can browse BMD Po, which is a service offered by the Microsoft Open Technologies, where the community can actually upload different types of Linux-based images for others to use and consume on Windows Azure. So here I can just browse to Ruby, and there will be several Ubuntu-based images for the Ruby stack. I will just choose the 1.9.31, which is the latest 1.9 version available. As you can see, these images are not published by Microsoft. In this case, it's a partner called Bitnami, and it's a 30 gigabyte image. On my next page, I just have to choose which Azure region I want to deploy this image, in which case I'll choose EC2S, and which storage account I will use for that. Once I click on complete, I will start copying this image from BMD Po, and it will be available for deployment on Windows Azure. So this process takes some minutes, since it's going to copy 30 gigabytes over the internet. I already have the image copied right here. It is in pending registration status, so all I need to do is to click on it and then go in the bottom to the register action. It will ask for a name, and it will set a URL for it. Defaults are just right, so I'll just click complete, and it will register the image for usage as an Azure VM. So I have several hundreds of images available on BMD Po, a handful of images related to Ruby and Ruby-based applications that I can choose from. And once the image has been registered for use here on Azure, I don't have to repeat the process anymore. I can just start creating as many instances, which are called VM instances, as I need for my work. So today we're going to set up this instance with the image that I get from BMD Po, and on top of that, I will create a Rails application that will be available for public access from my browser. So now that the image has been registered, I just go to Instances, and then I choose New. Virtual Machine is already selected because it correctly guesses that it is what I'm trying to do. And I can create from Gallery. As you can see, there are several Microsoft published images here, not only for Windows, but also for Ubuntu, CentOS, SUSE, and OpenSUSE. In this case, I just want to go to My Images and choose my Ruby stack image that I already registered. I will put a name on it, so let's say PRRuby01. I can choose the size of the image that I want to run, small is okay, and then there's a username that needs to be set up. It is by default Azure user, and I can upload an SSH key for authentication, or I can provide a password, which is what I'm going to do here, just for simplicity. So I can use existing cloud services. So cloud services are groups of Azure services that I put together for ease of administration, and particularly for affinity in terms of geographical availability. In this case, I will create a new one. As you can see, it's called the same as the virtual machine name that I just set up. I'm also choosing EC2S because that's where the image is. And if I had several resources, I can create an availability set and group them together in order to have redundancy and other geo-based solutions. So endpoints, I'm going to leave it like that just to illustrate what needs to be done afterwards. You can see that SSH is enabled by default. So this is just a way to open the port in the firewall so you can get into the VM afterwards. So we'll start creating the VM and then it will boot it up. As I mentioned, the purpose of this brief tutorial is to go through the creation of a VM depot based Ruby instance and then setting up a brief application so you can see how web development will look like on top of Azure for those of you that use Ruby for development. Once my Ruby VM is running on Azure, I can just go ahead and use a standard SSH client for Windows to log in. So I'll just type in the name of my VM. It will ask for credentials, which I already set up when I instantiated the VM, and I have logged in into this Ubuntu VM with the Bitnami Ruby stack 1.9.3 right here. I'll just go ahead and escalate to root, and then I'll cd into stack, which is the full Ruby stack that I can start using right ahead. I'll go into the Ruby console. And I'll cd into projects, which already has some projects right there. I'll delete this one. I'll start from scratch. And I'll create a new Rails app using standard Ruby tools. In this case, I'll use the Rails command. It will create a folder with some files. And after that, I'll create a scaffold for a sample blog post application. And then I'll create a sample database file using SQLite, which is the standard development tool that comes right here. So I'll just cd into this a folder. And one thing is that the next step requires the JavaScript execution environment. So if you don't have it, you can use apt and installed Node.js in this case. It's important to highlight, if you go to the sources file on this Ubuntu system, that Ubuntu is using the Azure archive, so it's going to be a pretty fast process to install packages and to upgrade the system if you have the need. So I'll just go ahead and generate a new scaffold. It's going to have a name, it's going to have a title, and it's going to have some content. So after it creates the necessary files, I'll just create the SQLite database using Rake. And I'm just gonna make sure, because I'm gonna deploy this on Apache using Passenger, and it runs with a specific user that does not, it's not root, and it does not have permissions for the DB file and for the DB directory where this file is included. So right now it's all root. So I will change the group owner, and the user that the Bitnami Ruby stack uses is daemon. So I'll change the group for the DB folder, and I'll change the group for the SQLite file, and I'll add write permissions on the folder and the SQLite file. So right now I'm pretty much done. I will just make sure that the configuration file of the stack for Apache contains the necessary passenger line. So just search for passenger right here, and right at the end I've added this virtual host section where I am pointing to my project, which is called blog app, and I'm also adding here mention to my Rails environment, which is development, because I want to use the SQLite database that I just created. And since I don't have any other virtual host, I can just use a sample server name and it will get caught by Apache. So right now I can use the control script that the Bitnami stack has in order to stop and make sure that everything is stopped. So Apache, Redis, and all the other components of the stack are stopped, and then start the components. And meanwhile I'll just check here in the Azure portal that there is an endpoint for HTTP, which is TCP port 80, just to make sure that I can access the app after it boots. So it is in fact created. Also in this portal, I can take a look at the dashboard and take a look at, you know, the resources that I'm using and the rest of the variables for this particular VM. And now that Apache has started, I can just go ahead and access the app using my browser. And if I go to posts, then I can create a new post. Let's say Azure open source rocks on Azure. This is for more, and then create post. And now it's being created. I can go back and I can see it, and I can also go to my project. I go to DB, access the SQLite database, and see the posts that are being created there. Now, if I'm not using the Bitnami Ruby stack, if I have my own, then I can just go ahead and choose from a different set of virtual machines from the gallery. So we have Ubuntu, CentOS, SUSE, and you know, OpenSUSE, or I can just go to BNDpo and search for more. So this one, for example, is a 2.0 Ruby stack that I can also deploy. Or if I'm using my own hypervisor infrastructure, I can use the virtual disks and I can upload them to Windows Azure and run them on Windows Azure with some preparation. Now, next steps would be to go to the Windows Azure Ruby Developer Center. I can download the Azure SDK, which is not only for Windows. I can download the command line tools for Linux and Mac as well. It's open source, available on GitHub. And I can start, since I've just started creating my web application, I can start consuming other Azure services such as blobs, tables, and also messaging, service bus, queues, and any other of the REST-based solutions that are available on Azure. So I can search the docs and I can browse tutorials and several resources that are available for free on WindowsAzure.com, the Ruby Developer Center, and I can create each one of the services I need, say databases or storage or tables or queues or bus-based applications, and consume them from Ruby. So hopefully this has been a useful a short video on how to create and deploy your first app, Ruby app on Azure, by leveraging the existing open source features of this platform. Thanks so much for your time, and please let us know on Twitter @open@Microsoft for any more comments or feedback. Thank you.